he was a man in mind, in years a youth, and gallant in the din of war. Fleet, thick-maned chargers were written by the illustrious hero. A shield, light and broad, hung on the flank of his swift and slender steed. His sword was blue and gleaming. His spurs were of gold, his raiment was woolen. It will not be my part to speak of thee reproachfully. A more choice act of mine will be to celebrate thy praise in song. Thou hast gone to a bloody bier sooner than to a nuptial feast. Thou hast become a meal for ravens ere thou didst reach the front of conflict. Alas, Owain, my beloved friend, it is not meet that he should be devoured by ravens. There is swelling sorrow in the plain where fell in death the only son of Maro, adorned with his wreath, leader of rustic warriors, whenever he came by his troop unattended, before maidens would he serve the meat. But the front of his shield would be pierced, if ever he heard the shout of war. No quarter would he give to those whom he pursued, nor would he retreat from the combat until blood flowed. And he cut down like rushes the man who would not yield. The Gododdin relates that on the coast of Mordiae, before the tents of Madoc, when he returned, but one man in 100 with him came, adorned with his wreath, the chief of toil, his country's rod of power, darted like an eagle to our harbors, when a lord to the compact that had been formed, his ensign was beloved. More nobly was his emblazoned resolution performed, for he retreated not, with a shrinking mind, before the host of Gododdin. Manawid, with confidence and strength thou pressest upon the tumultuous fight. Nor dost thou regard either spear or shield. No habitation rich in dainties can be found that has been kept out of the reach of thy warrior's charge. Adorned with a wreath was the leader, the wolf of the holm. Amber beads and ringlets encircled his temples. Precious was the amber, worth a banquet of wine. He repelled the violence of men as they glided along, for Venedosha and the North would have come to his share. By the advice of the son of Gerone, the hero of the broken shield, adorned with his wreath was the leader, and armed in the noisy conflict. Chief object of observation was the hero, and powerful in the gory field. Chief fighter in the advanced division, in front of the hosts. Five battalions fell before his blades, even of the men of Davy Wire and Briney, uttering groans. 20 perished in one short hour. Sooner did he feed the wolf with his carcass, than go to the nuptial feast. He sooner became the raven's prey, than approached the altar. He had not raised the spear ere his blood streamed to the ground. This was the price of meat in the hall, amidst the throng. Hyveid her shall be celebrated whilst there remains a minstrel. The heroes marched to Gododdin, and Gona laughed. But bitter were they in the battle, when they stood arranged according to their several banners. Few were the years of peace which they had enjoyed. The son of Bot-God caused a throbbing by the energy of his hand. They should have gone to churches to do penance. The old and the young, the bold and the mighty. The inevitable strife of death was about to pierce them. The heroes marched to Gododdin, Gwanner laughed. As his jeweled army went down to the terrific toil. Thou slayest them with blades, when there is not much chattering. Thou, powerful supporter of the living law, produces the silence of death. The heroes marched to Catraeth, loquacious was the host. Blue mead was their liquor, and it proved their poison. In marshaled array they cut through the engines of war. And after the joyful cry, silence ensued. They should have gone to churches to perform penance. The inevitable strife of death was about to pierce them. The heroes marched to Catraeth, filled with mead and drunk. Compact and vigorous, I should wrong them were I to neglect their fame. Around the mighty, red, and murky blades, obstinately and fiercely the dogs of war would fight. If I had judged you to be of the tribe of Brianik, not the phantom of a man would I have left alive. I lost a friend, myself being unhurt. As he openly withstood the terror of the parental chief, magnanimously did he refuse the dowry of his father-in-law. Such was the son of Cian from the stone of Gwynjd. The heroes marched to Catraeth with the dawn. Their peace was disturbed by those who feared them. 100,000 with 300 engaged in mutual overthrow. Drenched in gore, they marked the fall of the lances. The post of war was most manfully and with gallantry maintained. Before the retinue of Miney dogged the courteous. The heroes marched to Catraeth with the dawn. Feelingly did their relatives regret their absence. Mead they drank, yellow, sweet, and snaring. That year is the point to which many a minstrel turns. Redder were their swords than their plumes. Their blades were white as lime, and into four parts were their helmets cloven. Even those of the retinue of Miney Dog the courteous. The heroes marched to Catraeth with the day. Was not the most celebrated of battles disgraced? They put to death Jelleroid with blades. The gem of baptism was thus widely taunted. Better that you should, ere you join your kindred, have a gory unction and death far from your native homes. At the hand of the host of Gododdin, when the day arrives, is not a hero's power best when tempered with discretion? The hero marched to Catraeth with the day. Truly he quaffed the white meat on serene nights. Miserable, though success had been predicted, proved his mission, which he undertook through soaring ambition. There hastened not to Catraeth a chief, with such a magnificent design of enterprise, blazoned on his standard. Never was there such a host. From the fort of Aden, that would scatter abroad the mounted ravagers. Tudvulture, deprived of his land and towns, slaughter the Saxons for 7 days. His valor should have protected him and freedom. His memory is cherished by his fair associates. When Tudvulch arrived, the supporter of the land, the post of the son of Kili became a plain of blood. The heroes marched to Catraeth with the dawn. But none of them received protection from their shields. To blood they resorted, being assembled in gleaming armor. In the van was, loud as thunder, the din of targets. The envious, the fickle, and the base. Would he tear and pierce with halberds? From an elevated position he slew, with a blade, in iron affliction, their steel-clad commander. He subdued the Mordii that owed him homage. Before it high even an army groaned. When the tale shall be told of the Battle of Catraeth, the people will utter sighs. Long has been their grief on account of the warrior's absence. There will be a dominion without a sovereign, and a smoking land. The sons of Godbog, an upright clan, bore the furrower on a long bier. Miserable was the fate, though just the necessity, decreed for Tudvulch and Sivulch the Tall. Together they drank the bright mead by the light of torches, though pleasant to the taste, it proved a lasting foe. Before, above the splendid fort of a king he showed a frowning aspect. Whilst young and forward men composed his retinue. Before, on the blood, with the horn shearer's heart. Making all the Mordii full of joy. Before, his beverage would be bragging. Before, he displayed the grandeur of gold and rich purple. Before, pampered steeds would bear him safe away. Even Gwarthlev, who deserved a comely name. Before, the victorious chief would turn aside the ebbing tide. His command was ever to go forward, loath was he to skulk.